everyone. It is good to have you with us. Paul, thank you. Beautiful, wonderful time of worshiping the Lord. You know, our God he's worthy of our worship. Amen? Yeah, he deserves that. It's a blessing. It's a privilege. It's a joy. We can approach the throne of God, Hebrews tells us, with boldness and confidence. What an incredible privilege. It's a lot more than just singing. And I'm glad because I'm not that good a singer. honestly, you would not want to hear me sing with a microphone in my hand. But it is, I still love to praise the Lord, and I still think he likes all of our praises. A joyful noise. Amen? Amen. It's good to have you with us. I don't know if you were here. Some of you were. A lot of you were here yesterday for the showing of the War Room movie. What a wonderful picture. What a wonderful show. What a inspirational kind of a movie. And so thanks again to the ladies ministry. They are the ones that inspired the War Room coming and watching that. And I know it was my second time. And again, just even a greater joy and blessing and encouragement even the second time around. So anyway, if you have not seen that, you still have an opportunity. Of course, you can rent it if you want to do that, but we are going to be showing it at Bayside on the Hill 2 weeks from yesterday. Okay, so 6 p.m., our normal Bayside on the Hill Duluth service time, and you can come and check it out there as well. But it is a good movie, and it has inspired, it was a part of the inspiration for us talking about prayer. And so we talked about prayer last week, and I, again, called last week, Praying Like Jesus. And so I didn't know what else to call it. I didn't want to get creative. So this is Praying Like Jesus Part 2, okay? You like my super creativity? Yeah, thank you. Praying Like Jesus Part 2. And again, if there's anything that I think my desire for us is that we would truly, and I know this can sound cliche, but I don't think it has to be, that we would come out of this season where the Lord is re-energizing us, re-encouraging us, maybe in a new way, inspiring us to pray more like Jesus prayed. And you know, that's my heart. That you know, and maybe you're like me, your spirit desires, something inside of you desires to pray more like Jesus prayed. Amen? But Jesus made it really clear when his disciples were praying. He said, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Yeah. So that's the reality of Mark. The reality of Mark, and maybe you can relate to this if you're a human being, you know, our spirits, if they have been molded and changed and regenerated, made new by the Holy Spirit, we want to pray more like Jesus. But the reality is we still live in this flesh, and so it's challenging. And so this morning, I want to talk maybe more about a reality of prayer, okay, and maybe a balance in prayer. You know, sometimes we talk about prayer as focus and focused prayers. And last week, I think, was that. We talked about prayer, if you remember, as a spiritual, you remember, weapon. That was the tagline for the War Room. We talked about prayer literally as one of the weapons we use to engage in the spiritual reality, the battle that is real. Now, today I want to talk about prayer again, and I think praying like Jesus, but I want to talk more of a balance in prayer. Okay, the War Room really inspired us that prayer is powerful. And prayer can change things, and prayer stirs up God, and many times prayer can move the hand of God, and prayer can do much. And if you believe that prayer still changes things today, please give me an amen. And I do too. You know, in one of the greatest verses or sets or passages within prayer can do anything is found in the book of James. And so I want to begin in James chapter 5. This is not going to be the extent of where we're going to go. This is going to be the first half of the balancing scales that I want to talk about today in prayer, both of which are ultimately true. But I want to begin with one side of that, and really prayer as powerful and able to do many things. So James 5, I want to start in verse 13. He's going to talk about suffering and affliction, and I think that's a reality of life. Again, because we are human and because we live in a broken, sinful world, suffering and affliction and those things are real, aren't they? And I don't have to convince you of that. You have your own areas of life that you wish you could change, and so do I. We suffer. That's a promise, not a negative thing that has happened because necessarily we've done everything wrong, okay? James 5, I want to start in verse 13. Is anyone among you suffering? I want to ask for a raise of hands for that. Okay, I know some of you are, and I know in certain ways we all are. Let him pray. Our suffering should lead us to pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise. Well, we already did that. We can check that off the list of things to do today. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. We've done that multiple times. We will do that for any individual that says, you know what, I'm sick. And sickness can come in a lot of forms. It is physical, but it's not just physical. And we have prayed as elders here at Bayside. We have prayed over people, anointing them with oil. And I still believe this to be a very true and a sincere and a viable way to pray for folks that are sick. And if you would like that, please come up to myself or any of the leaders here, and we will do that because I still believe that praying over people and anointing them with oil is still something the Lord would have us to do today. Why do I believe that? James said it, and ultimately God inspired James to say it, so I believe it. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. Healing, raising up, saving, forgiving, prayer. Powerful prayers. Prayers that change things. Prayers that heal. Prayers that deliver. Prayers that do things that only God can do. Prayer is powerful. And I hope you are like me and that you still believe that prayer can do some powerful things. I want to begin actually in prayer, and I guess that's good and very appropriate this morning. But I want to begin in prayer. You know, the reality of the situation is prayer can do a lot of things. Prayer can heal. Prayer can save. But not every person gets healed. Do they? Not every person, their sickness is taken away, is it? Not every prayer that we pray in great faith gets answered in the way that we want it to get answered, does it? That's the balance that I want to talk about this morning. That prayer is powerful, and prayer can do amazing things that only prayer can do. But not every prayer of ours gets answered in the way that we would like it to get answered. Have you ever experienced that, my friends? That's the balance in prayer that I want to talk about this morning. So let's pray and let's ask the Lord to be with us. Heavenly Father, we do come to you. God, we believe that you are a God who answers prayers. We believe that you are still stirred by the requests and the petitions and the crying out of your people. We believe that. Father, we believe these verses that say prayer can do some amazing things because prayer is stirring you up. Father, we trust that you are still a God who can heal, who can save, who can deliver, and we know you are a God who forgives. So God, we come to you in that light of who you are as an amazing, powerful God and who is still stirred by our prayers. And the other reality is, Lord, sometimes our prayers are not answered in the way that we wish they would be. And yet we've prayed with great faith and fervency and diligence and persistence. Father, we feel we've done our part, and yet sometimes it doesn't seem to go the way we wish it would go. And so, Father, help us this morning to understand the balance in prayer of you as a mighty and powerful answerer of prayers, but yet not everything going our way all the time. So God, I just want to lift up this day to you. I ask your Holy Spirit to be with us in these moments. May you be glorified in all of these things. And I just thank you so much. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. You know, James 5:16 became one of my very early in my walk with Jesus' favorite verses. And my first Bible that I really got into studying, it still sits in my office right back there, was a King James study Bible. And so this James 5:16, the second half of this in the King James version, I just love it. So I want to read this to you, the second half, out of the King James. Listen to this, and just this is just good language, okay? The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Okay, that is just poetic, isn't it? But I want you to think about that. The effectual fervent, that is the Greek word energeo. It probably sounds like a word that we use, energy. The energetic, the fervent, the active, the effective, and the effectual prayer of a righteous man or person avails, can do much. Now, I believe this to be true, that when we are energetic and fervent and active and alive in prayer, there is much that God can do through that. Now, I want to just talk for a moment about who is a righteous man, because I think this is a twofold answer to what does it mean to be righteous. There is a positional righteousness, and then there is a practical righteousness. Let me define that. First of all, a positional righteousness. When you trusted in Jesus Christ alone, when you put your faith in Christ, that he was the God-man who took sin upon himself, your sin, and you trusted that he did that for you, that you were a sinner in need of a savior, and you trusted that Jesus Christ alone saved you, you became righteous. Not because of anything that you had done. That righteousness was what was called imputed, or just simply given to you because of all that Christ did. Now, righteousness is right standing before God in this regard. So you have a right standing before God. The Bible says you have peace now with God, and it had nothing to do with what you did or what you could do. It was simply a righteousness that was given to you, poured over you, if you will, because of the righteousness of Jesus. And so now you are positionally clothed with the righteousness of Christ. So only a believer is positionally righteous. You are holy before God, not because you or I are that terribly holy, but because we have been clothed with Christ, who is holy. Can I get an amen? Amen. See, that's positional righteousness. And that, I believe, is the first step, that our righteousness has nothing to do with what we did, do, or ever could do, because our righteous deeds are kind of filthy compared to the holiness and righteousness of God. So the first righteousness is positional, but there is also a righteousness that comes from what we do. 1 John 3 talks about this, and it says that he who does righteousness is righteous. So the other part of righteousness is obedience and doing the right thing. So we have to understand that righteousness is twofold. It is not only this imputed or given righteousness because of Christ. It is also walking in the right way that God would have us to walk, walking in obedience. So this verse, there is power in prayer. Number one, when we have trusted in Jesus Christ and we are saved. But there is also greater power in prayer when we are walking obediently according to the best of our ability to his word. Let me give you an example on this. Let's say a father has two children, natural birth by a mother or adopted, either way. Okay, these two children are in. They are in the family. They have been adopted. They are every bit a part of the family. They are in. They are a part. That is positional righteousness. But now let's say one of these two children is extremely, and you guys can't relate to this, you parents, or maybe you children either. No, one of these children is extremely well-behaved. No, you can relate to that one, okay? Let's say they're just well-behaved. They're not perfect, but they're really trying their best, and they're starting to understand the father's heart in the matter, and they're starting to try to live that and walk that, but they're really trying their best. And then you have this other child, and this is the one you can't relate to, that's extremely naughty. The naughty kid. Yeah, I can't relate to that at all in my home. But let's just take these two children as an example. Are they both part of the family? Yes. Are they both every bit a son or daughter of the father and the mother? Yes, they are. There is not one that is more or that is less. But let me ask you this. Which one, if they ask their father or mother for something, which one is more likely to get the request that they ask for?
Yeah.
Not naughty boy. Do you see what I'm saying? It is very natural for a father to give more requests. The other thing is that a child who is walking more in line with the heart of the father is going to ask for things that are less selfishly motivated. And I know that for myself. When I am walking more in line, when I am abiding more in the vine of Jesus Christ, when I am walking more the way I should walk, I just ask many times differently. I ask more according to the will of God and less according to the will of Mark. Do you know what I'm saying? Can you relate to that? Do I believe that prayer has great power? Yes. Do I believe that the effectual, fervent, energetic prayer of a righteous one avails, can do much? Yes, I do. And I hope that you do too. Yet the struggle comes when God doesn't answer our prayers. And sometimes we can just instantly put that on, well, maybe I'm just the naughty child. But that is not always necessarily the case. We struggle when the Lord does not answer our prayers. And sometimes this is lighthearted and can be funny, and sometimes this is terribly serious and tragic and awful. If we're honest, some of the prayers that we pray, things that we want done, are very serious and they're very significant in our lives. And sometimes the Lord just doesn't answer things the way we wish he would answer them. Do you have those areas in your life? And so do I. We're talking about praying like Jesus. I want to go back to the passage where Jesus was teaching his disciples to pray, Matthew chapter 6. This has been called the Lord's Prayer. I was thinking about this passage from Matthew 6 last night as we were at Bayside on the Hill. And as we were worshiping, and the Lord gave me this thought, you know, Matthew chapter 6, I think we've made it a model for prayer. And maybe we've taken prayer and we've made it just exclusively this thing, these words that we say. But the Bible tells us to pray without, remember what he says? Ceasing, without stopping, praying at all times in the Spirit, which means that prayer is probably just as much an attitude that I carry out my day with as the words that I say when I sit or kneel or stand to pray. And maybe when Jesus was teaching his disciples to pray, it was about the words found in Matthew 6, but maybe this was also an attitude, and the way that he formulated the Lord's Prayer was an attitude that we must come to the Lord with. And when we come to the Lord with this attitude, in this order, specifically in the way that Jesus spoke this, it may help us in this struggle when the Lord does not answer all of our prayers according to our wishes. So I want to look at Matthew chapter 6, the Lord's Prayer, and I want to think about this more in terms of an attitude, more in terms of an understanding than even specifically maybe the words that we say when we pray. Do I feel words are important? Yes. But look with me, if you will. Can we pull up Matthew 6? Pray then like this. Jesus was telling his disciples. I'm just going to read it, and then I want to just take a couple of these passages. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Look at the order he puts this in and think of an attitude that could be developed by praying in this way. Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Verse 11 is our primary prayer concerns, generally speaking. Give us this day our daily bread. We pray about the bread a lot. It is real? Yes. It is a need? Yes. We pray verse 11 a lot. Forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. What if the Lord's Prayer was not just simply the words and a model for the words that we say, but what if it was an attitude that we had to grasp, to pray and to commune? See, prayer at its heart is communing with the Lord. It's not just saying words. But what if this was an attitude, and if we came to the Lord with an attitude based upon what he is telling us, how he was teaching his disciples to pray without ceasing, then we would understand this balance better in our lives, praying more like Jesus. Look at this. Pray then like this. Our Father. Let's start there. What if the first thing we have to realize when we pray is we are praying not to a non-caring God? Not to simply a powerful God, even though he is that. Not to a God that we don't have relationship. What if we started in prayer by saying, no, this is my Father. Now, depending upon the father that you had, and I'll put myself in this, I have not been a perfect model of father. And I think that is partially why maybe we struggle with our spiritual father, because we just haven't had the perfect model, and as a father, there is no perfect model. But you know what? We have to pray with the understanding that we are praying to a father, to a dad, to an Abba who cares deeply about us. We have to start with this attitude that says, you are not just God, you are my father. I'm not just coming to a king. I am coming to a king, but I am coming to my and our father who loves me, who happens to be the most powerful in all of the universe. Then he says, hallowed be your name. Hallowed means holy. We must maybe then move in an attitude that we are coming to a father who loves us and cares and knows, and now this father is also holy. Maybe that holiness, that means he is literally set apart from the rest. He is ultimately different than us. He is higher than us. He is holy. In fact, he's holy, holy, holy. He is set apart beyond anything we could be set apart. And we approach him as such, as not only a God who is our Father, who loves us and who is close, but who is also infinitely different. He was ultimately set apart and who is holy beyond holy. So now he's not only our Father, he's holy. But look what he says, hallowed be your name. You know, when Moses was trying to get at God, when Moses didn't want to go to Pharaoh because he was afraid of what Pharaoh may do, and he said, Lord, I don't know if I can do this. Well, who should I say sent me? Well, what is your name, God? And remember what Jesus said? He said, my name is I am. You know, what a statement. I just did a little bit this week on the names of God. Maybe it's incredibly important that we know who God is as we are going to him. You know, his names describe his character. Listen to some of just a few of the many names of God in the Old Testament. He is Jehovah. Jehovah is the self-existent one. He just exists. He was not created. He is. Jehovah Ra, which means the Lord is my shepherd. Jehovah Rapha, which is the Lord that heals. Jehovah Jireh, which is the Lord that provides. Jehovah Shalom is the Lord of peace. El Shaddai is the Lord Almighty. El Elyon, which is the Lord Most High. El Olam, which is the everlasting God. You know, see, God reveals his character by his names. And when he is saying, our Father in heaven, holy, set apart is your name. Maybe when we go to him in prayer, it is important to know who he is. That he is provider. That he is healer. That he is, that's Jehovah Nissa. That he is the everlasting God. That he's all of those things. He is the I am. Jesus, we know from the book of John, fulfilled was the fulfillment of the I am, this picture of God. And so maybe when we go to prayer, there is an attitude that says, you are my Father. You are holy. You are set apart. And I must now know your name. Verse 10, he goes on to say, your kingdom come. You know, maybe there's an attitude in prayer that we need to have that it is all about God's kingdom that is coming. You see, God's kingdom, there was a beautiful picture of God's kingdom in the garden, but we know very clearly sin messed that up. And Jesus was coming to bring God's kingdom back to earth, this kingdom of relationship between God and man. And so maybe we need to understand that God has, he is the king, and he has a kingdom that is coming. And so maybe it's not about Mark's kingdom coming. And then he redefines that and he says, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You know, maybe there's an attitude in prayer that needs to be, God, it is about your will being done. It is not necessarily about Mark's will getting done. Does Mark have a will? Yes, he does. But maybe when I come to the Lord in prayer, my attitude needs to be, God, your kingdom come into my life, into my world. Your will be done in my life and my world, not my kingdom, not my will. And why is that? Because you are my Father. You are holy. You are set apart. And you are the great I am. You know, maybe we get to verse 11, Lord, give us this day our daily bread. Will you please provide for the very practical, important things that I need on this earth? Will you please answer some of these prayers? Maybe we get to verse 11 before we've really settled in our own hearts and minds, verse 9 and 10. Maybe when we settle verses 9 and 10 in our hearts and in our minds, verse 11 sort of takes care of itself.
Give us this day our daily bread. You know, I realized something. God doesn't answer all of our prayers according to our will, does he? He doesn't. But he does answer all of our prayers. Listen to 1 John 5:14. This, to me, gives us the balance between the Lord as a powerful answerer of prayers and maybe why sometimes they don't get answered in the way that I request them to be answered. 1 John 5:14, and this is the confidence. You see, we can pray with confidence. Many times when a prayer doesn't get answered, it racks and shakes up and destroys our confidence, doesn't it? Why didn't you do this, Lord? Why didn't you answer in this way, Lord? It shakes our confidence. But John says, on the other hand, this is the confidence that we have towards him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Now, does that mean he doesn't hear some of the prayers that are prayed not according to his will? Yeah, I believe that's true, because it says in Romans that the Holy Spirit reinterprets our prayers. So sometimes we pray for things that are not a part of our will, and that is the Holy Spirit interpreting those prayers, saying, you know, Mark said this, but we both know that he really needs this. So it is a reinterpretation. But whenever we ask for anything according to the will of God, God hears us. But now listen to the confidence that we can have. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the requests that we have asked us, that we have asked of him. So here's the confidence, my friends. Anytime you pray anything according to the will of God, he hears you. And when you pray according to the will of God, you will have the request that you have asked. That should give us incredible confidence. He hears, he knows, he answers 100% of the time when it is according to his will. So what happens when we don't receive what we have asked for? That's when the rub comes, doesn't it? That's when we lose confidence. But I want to encourage you with something, because this is to make us confident. Whenever we have asked for something, asked the Lord in prayer for something, and it has not happened, we can have confidence that it is not God's will for us to have that. Confidence. We can know that if we don't have what we asked for, we can be confident that it's not God's will. Now, it may not be God's will today. It may be God's will later on. It may be a timing issue. You know, God answers us in three ways: yes, no, and wait, maybe later. That's a fair answer for the Lord. Yes, no, wait, maybe later. But as his children, if we have not received what we asked for, we can have confidence that then it is ultimately not a part of his will for us as his child. Maybe now, maybe not now, maybe never, maybe later. So when we're faced with an answer that was not the answer that we wanted, there's not a kid around that minds the answer yes to a request. But when we receive an answer of no or maybe later, that's when the battle begins, doesn't it? That's when the battle rages. What will we do? Will we submit to the will of the Father, or will we struggle, lose confidence, lose faith? What will we do? You know, like any child, we may not understand why certain things happen. We may not understand why certain prayers don't get answered. We may think we know best about a lot of different things, and I'm with you in the we part of that. We may have to return to the Lord's Prayer, our Father, his name, his kingdom, his will. We may need to submit over and over and over and over again. You know, we often want these things to be answered in the way that we want them to be answered, and when they don't, it confuses us and it shakes us. Some of these situations are really hard to accept. death, premature death, is really, really hard to accept. It doesn't seem to make sense. Evil and terror reigning in this world, that doesn't seem to make any sense to me. Major health problems or diseases or acts of God that destroy lives. I don't get these things. I can't explain these things with great clarity, and so that will give you a satisfactory answer. I don't know why they happen. And so I may not be able to tell you what you want to hear in regard to those things, but I do know, I do believe that our God is still God. He is still our Heavenly Father. That our God can be glorified even in the midst of bad and tragic and horrific things. He can still be glorified in those things. That we see still very, in not in the fullness of the picture. We don't see that. You know, a submitted life. When God doesn't answer our prayers in the way that we want and we submit to the Lord and we say, you know what, I wish this would be different, but it's not. A submitted life is a powerful testimony to others. It is a powerful testimony when you and I live with the things that we wish we could change, but we can't. When we say, I will praise the Lord no matter what, even though this hasn't changed, I will praise Him anyway. I will give glory to my God even in the midst of this not changing. Even though this hasn't been answered in the way that I asked it, I will praise Him regardless. That is a powerful testimony. You've heard of folks like that. You've seen folks like that. We have folks in our midst who are continuing to praise the Lord who have lived with tragedy, and their lives are a great testimony. They are a great example that God is still God, and He is still faithful, and He is still worthy of our praise. Should we stop praying for physical healing? Of course not. We should pray fervently. Should we believe that our God can do anything and heal and change any situation? Of course we should believe that. He is God. He is the I Am. But please hear me in this. Our faith should not rest in the hope that God will always answer every prayer according to our will. Our faith should not rest in that hope. And there are people who will tell you that if you just have enough faith, God will give you what you want. And I'm here to tell you that's just not always true. Our faith should not rest in God answering every prayer according to what we would want. In fact, our battle is more in submitting to Him in the midst of things not going as we wish they would. I want to give you a very light, and I know with some of the serious stuff that we've talked about, this is light and this doesn't compare, but you know that I have had issues, personal issues with my back. I have made it very clear that I have now, at 40-something, arthritis in my back. Okay, and it is a pain in the back. Consistently, there's two things. Number one, I have a herniated disc that slips out and causes extreme pain when I do something wrong. And then it's sort of now chronic arthritic pain that is sort of there all the time. Praise the Lord for getting old. Only because I'm that much closer to heaven. Now, when this first started happening, I prayed so often, Lord, take this away. I do not like this. I wish this was gone. Can I get an amen from any chronic pain? Okay, thank you. And again, I know mine is minimal compared to some years, but just understand my heart that I'm sharing this in. Two times in the last probably year and a half after first service, when the back has been especially bad, I have come down for prayer and I have asked for prayer from people, from our prayers between services. And two times in the last year and a half, it's been really bad so that I didn't think I could stand for second service. I thought I would have to sit. Now, that wouldn't be a big deal, but I didn't want to sit because I like walking around. And so I asked our prayers. I said, would you please pray for my back so that I can just get through second service? And Kathy Nelson was the first one. And Kathy said, yes, I will pray for you. And she laid her hand upon my back. And I literally felt a warm tingling go through my back. And the pain literally went away in seconds. Seconds. Is our God still a healer? Amen. Amen. He's a healer. The second time was last week. Lynn Hofstad and Cindy Rodriguez, right over there after first service, I asked them the same exact thing. I'm like, man, this is kind of a pain in the back. Will you guys pray for me? It wasn't as fast, instantaneous, and warm, but it went away over the next 10 or 15 minutes, and I was able to walk back up here second service and preach, and I had no pain. No pain. Do I believe God can still heal? Yes, I do. Our God is a healer. Now, I will tell you, as I sit here this morning, I have pain in my back. What? Thought you were a healer. Why is it still there? Now, I was not always at this place because this has been developing over the years, but I will tell you this, that I have realized now, and when I was praying for my back to be healed, I didn't fully put this together until recently, that this pain in my back has now become something that is very important in my life, because I've shared this at different times. I can get a little obsessive about things. And I got very excessive in the last couple of decades about exercise. Some of you are like, dude, you're nuts, man. You are crazy. And I got a little obsessive. No, a lot obsessive. Okay, let's be really, really honest. It became an idol. The idol was ultimately me, but it was playing out through this obsessive behavior. And now this back chronic arthritis is something that keeps me from that idolatry. And so now I praise the Lord. Lord, thank you for this arthritic back, because it keeps me from something that would be far worse than arthritis, which is idolatry. It keeps me closer to Jesus. And so now I don't want it to go away. Now it keeps me in a place of great humility. It keeps me in a place where I am closer with Jesus. And so now I will praise the Lord in this weakness, because it stops something that is far more detrimental than just simply feeling physically perfect all the time. Did I always see it that way? No. No. In fact, a lot of times I really, really got kind of upset that this was the reality. Can I still do all of the things I do? Yeah, when I behave and do what I need to do for this back, can I still do all of the things I want to do? Yes, I can. Yes, I can. And now I am thankful. Did I always see it with that type of clarity? No, I did not. But now I do. Sometimes the reason the Lord doesn't answer all of our prayers according to our will is because there is a greater glory that we just don't see. There is something that we are not seeing. And when our prayers and when these things that we wish we could change but they don't, when they cause us to connect to the Lord more intimately, that is a greater glory. And so many times these struggles do that for us. I'm going to go through this really quickly. So why doesn't God answer all our prayers according to our will? Five things, five verses. This is going to be fast, my friends, okay? Why doesn't God answer all our prayers according to our will? Why are we allowed to suffer when God could change things? Number one, we don't see the full picture. 1 Corinthians 13:12. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. We think we see with great clarity, but the reality is we don't. We have to understand only God sees with perfect clarity. Number two, why doesn't God answer all our prayers according to our will? So we can comfort others. Our sufferings make us more empathetic towards others. 2 Corinthians 1:3-4. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction. Look at, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. Sometimes the only person that can really minister to you when you are going through something very awful is somebody who understands what you're going through. And so God allows some of these things so that we can minister better to others. It makes us more empathetic like Jesus. Number three, why doesn't God answer all our prayers according to our will? Because difficulties develop our character. The challenges of life make us more like Jesus. James 1, 2-4, count it all joy, my brothers and sisters, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. You've experienced this, so have I. We don't like it in process, but it's a reality. Our difficulties, our challenges, they develop our character. And so until that character trait is developed in us, the trial, the affliction, the thing that we wish would go away doesn't necessarily go away. If God is in the process of developing who we are to be more like Jesus. Number four, why doesn't God answer all of our prayers according to our will? It keeps us humble and makes us strong. This is a powerful verse of Paul's greatest affliction, the thing he wished he could change. He called it his thorn in the flesh. Powerful. 2 Corinthians 12, 7-10, Paul saw a great vision of the third heaven. And to keep him from becoming prideful, he says this, so to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. I want to pause. Our afflictions, the enemy said, a messenger of Satan to harass him. We need to realize that in our afflictions, the enemy is going to try to get at those things. He is going to use those. He is going to try to make you vulnerable in those areas of your great affliction. The Lord is using them for many positive things, but the enemy will come in and attack you in your areas of great affliction. And so these times when we are being challenged and it is difficult are great times when we must go to the Lord. And we must seek him, and we must pray to him. Now look at what Paul did. Three times I pleaded with the Lord about this. Three times, very significant, pleaded, begged the Lord about this, that it should leave me. Paul was saying, God, I don't like this thorn in the flesh. I'm just trying to do your work. I'm trying to be the man that you want me to be. Why this? And once wasn't enough, and so he went to him twice, and twice wasn't enough, so he went to him three times. And he poured out his heart asking God to change this situation and take this out of his life. And Paul was a good man. He was not a perfect man, but he was a good man. But to keep him humble, he was given this thorn. But look what God said to him. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am what? Strong. You see, these things that we wish we could change but don't change, they keep us humble. And they make us strong. Because in Christ, we are only strong when we are more and more and more in Christ. And the more that we abide in the vine of Jesus Christ, the greater his strength flows into us. And so he develops humility in us by these things and makes us actually strong in these things. Number five, the final one. Why doesn't God answer all of our prayers according to his will, according to our will? Well, we live in a broken world. You know, I told you that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. And when he was teaching his disciples to pray, he said, Lord, just pray this, God, your will be done. And if you read that passage, there seems to be no anxiety when Jesus was theoretically teaching his disciples to pray. He wasn't worked up when he was telling folks, you know what, just pray, God, your will be done. There was no anxiety, there was no turmoil, there was no anxiousness. You know, when you and I just sit here and we talk about, okay, how many of you want the Lord's will in your life? You'd raise your hand. The rub doesn't come when we are talking theoretically. The struggle never comes about God's will when our will and his will are working the same. And when Jesus was teaching his disciples to pray, there was no issue. But look at what happened when Jesus was getting ready to go to the cross. When Jesus was preparing to go and become sin, drink the full wrath of God. Look at what he says about his will and the Father's will. And look at what happens when Jesus, remember Jesus was the God-man. The God part of Jesus had settled a long time ago that he was going to become sin and he was going to the cross. But now the man side of Jesus, when faced with the cross, when faced with the suffering, when faced with all of the things that he was not looking forward to, the human side of Jesus, look what happens when that was not becoming something that he was necessarily desiring. And I don't blame him for that at all. Luke 22:39.
And he came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. And when he came to the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not enter into temptation." And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and he prayed. See, we're talking about power in prayer. And I believe we are going to see now one of the most powerful prayers that Jesus ever uttered. And in our lives, this is one of the most powerful prayers that we can utter, is this prayer. Verse 41 again, he withdrew from them about a stone's throw and knelt down and prayed, saying, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done." And there appeared to him an angel from heaven strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. The other gospels tell us he went back and prayed three times. Three times for about an hour on each occasion of prayer, praying the same prayer. "God, if you can remove this cup, if there is any way I don't have to drink of this, God, if this cannot happen, God, if I could change this in my humanness, I would change this. If there's any other way, God, that this can get done, please let this cup of your wrath pass from me. Please, Lord." And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat became like great drops of blood falling to the ground. You know, the greatest conflict in Jesus' life was when his will, in the human part of who Jesus was, did not match up with God's will for him. There was not a greater moment of agony, or moments or hours of agony in Jesus' life, than in the surrendering of his will. You want to talk about the most powerful prayers that we can pray? It is the surrendering of our will to God. Powerful prayers. "God, I submit to you." Why? Because you are my Father. And you are holy. And you are the great I am. And God, I trust you. Even though I would like to change this if I could, if there's any way that this can pass, Paul said it, if there's any way, pleaded with the Lord, "Take this from me," three times. If there's any way that you can take this from me, please do. "Yet, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done." Why? Because your grace, O God, is sufficient. Your grace is enough. Jesus submitted to the Father's will. He settled it a long time ago, but when push came to shove and when he was faced with the cross, it was the greatest struggle that we read of in Jesus' life. You know, we all have those thorns in the flesh, don't we? We all have them. We're going to prepare for a time where we receive communion and we remember again the body and the blood of Jesus. And that blood, the flow of that blood started in Gethsemane. It started in the garden. It started when he submitted again, settled in his mind and in his heart, "I'm going to the cross. I will drink the full wrath of God." And what I want to encourage you to do is, just in these next couple of moments, I want you to identify, what is my thorn? What is that thing in life that I have asked the Lord about? Maybe I've even pleaded with him about, that if I could change it, if I were God, I would change it. Maybe it's something that has happened in the past. Maybe it's something that is happening in the present. Or maybe it's a fearful thing that you perceive happening in the future. I don't know what your thorn is, but you do. And as we prepare for communion, my strong encouragement is to take these moments and to, again, submit, surrender the thorn to the Lord. Submit it again and say, "God, you know I would change this, but not my will, but yours be done." And then begin to remember and thank the Lord that he did that for you. Jesus surrendered his will to the Lord. And because he did that, we now have eternal life. So in the next couple of moments, surrender, submit, give your thorn. Give your thorn back to the Lord. And then we'll remember all that Jesus did together. And then Pastor Thomas, he'll come up and lead us in communion.
Heavenly Father, I do thank you. Jesus, I thank you that you gave your life for us. You submitted your will to your Father in great agony. Jesus, you know what it's like to submit. You know what it's like to truly pray in agony, not my will, but yours be done. You know that. You were tempted in every way as we are. Father, I pray that we would now give these thorns over, realizing your grace is sufficient, and we can be content in that, because when we are weak, we are actually strong. Jesus, I thank you that you gave us the model of this. I pray that you would help us to identify, help us to submit, no matter how deep these thorns have wounded us. I pray that we would, in these moments, submit them over to you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Before the elements are served, we just want to encourage you that you do not need to be a member of our church. You don't even need to be a regular attender if you're here for the first time. If you believe in what Jesus did for us, we invite you to join us as we remember his broken body and his blood that was shed for us. Would you bow with me? God, there are many things in this room on the hearts of every one of us, of your people. And we lift them to you now, Lord. And we say, may your will be done. And we look to Jesus. And we remember what he did. Not only in taking the bread and breaking it and saying to take this, but to remember him. And to remember his broken body and what it means to us. May your will be done. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus took the bread and he broke it and he said, this bread represents my broken body. It is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let's break and take this bread in remembrance of him. Again, Lord, we come before you humbled. Our Father in heaven, we just come before you and we say, may your will be done. And we thank you as we remember Jesus' broken body and his blood that was shed so that we have the freedom and so that we may have the confidence to come before you, to serve you, to live for you. And we just thank you for your forgiveness, for salvation, and for being able to know that we have an eternity with you coming. May your will be done as we remember the blood of Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. In the same way he took the cup, and we take it, and we drink this, because this is the new covenant of his blood, and we drink this in remembrance of him. Would you stand with me as we close our service this morning? We want to encourage you, if you have something you would like to come before God in prayer, we do have prayer teams. Pastor Mark, the other Pastor Mark, myself, and our prayer teams will be around. We have deacons available. And so if there's something that has been on your heart or your mind, we want to encourage you to come forward or to find one of us, and we would love to and would be willing to pray with you. And as always, join us in the fellowship hall after the service for refreshments, coffee, and whatever else they might be serving back there. We'd just love to spend some time with you and hang out today. But again, thank you for being here, and would you bow with me as we pray? God, we just praise you and we thank you, God. I am so grateful to stand before you today, a sinner saved by grace. And each one of us are so thankful and grateful for the love that you have for us, God. We thank you that you have blessed us with a church that we can come and worship you. We can gather in fellowship and we can open your word. And God, I just pray now that as a church, as we walk out the doors today, that we would continue to be your hands and your feet, loving each other and loving this world and serving others, all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And so we just pray that you will bless this day now until we meet again. And we thank you so much for these things. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. God bless and have a great day.